Namaste, poker homies. Navanat on No Limit Hold'em, and today we're going to be talking about equity, specifically an equity model, and very specifically, we're going to be talking mostly about preflop equity and the preflop equity model, what it is, and how useful it is or is not. Before we get into all that, I think we should probably just define explicitly what we mean when we say equity. And you could just say, what's the percent of the pot that you would expect your hand to capture on average if there were no more folding in the hand? That's a good way to think about it. If this hand is guaranteed to go to showdown, what percent of the pot does it win on average by getting to showdown and making or being the best hand? And when we're talking about equity, and we're talking about specifically equity with regards to our preflop game, I think we have to be very careful that we kind of stay on the same page, we have a consensus, everybody knows what we're talking about, because there are different ways to look at equity and what that could actually be referring to pre-flop. You could just say this hand, you know, ace x is a strong hand because it has, you know, better equity than most other potential hands, and on some level it does kind of all get derived from just how good a hand's equity is compared to all the other possible hands. But that's not the most practical level to kind of think on. And you could think more in terms of, you know, realistic ranges of hands that your opponents could play. But I think the best way to think about it, because if you're thinking about just your equity versus certain ranges that would open or hands that people tend to play, then you might have the following kind of thought. Here I am on the button. I've got this hand. My opponent opens cutoff, and I've got a big equity advantage over his open raising range, therefore I'm going to 3-bet. That's not a good way to think. A better way to think about it would be, and this still kind of misses the mark a little bit, but it's a more practical way to look at it. A better way to look at it would be, if I choose to 3-bet and my opponent calls, how much equity do I have versus his continuance range? Again, not exactly perfect, but definitely we're on the right page there. We're going in the right direction. Okay, we're in the ballpark at least. Now I want to talk about post-flop equity a little bit before we start talking about what's wrong with the pre-flop equity model and why it doesn't really work that well. I think we should at least talk about post-flop equity, because understanding and modeling your understanding and strategy based on your post-flop equity, it makes a little more sense, and it still has many caveats, and there's still a lot to add to and take away from, but there is it is pretty useful to know what amount of equity a hand has against a given range once you get to the turn and you're facing a bet. This is for sure an important concept. You know, I mean, we should be thinking in terms of game theory optimal to design our ranges. But really that breaks down to, or it comes from, or stems out of, or follows from the fact that we want to make as few mistakes in terms of the fundamental theorem of poker as possible while allowing or inducing mistakes from our opponents. And that's kind of the object of the game. That's sort of the way that you want to think about poker, is it's mostly just a game about who makes the fewest mistakes in terms of EV in accordance with the fundamental theorem of poker. And ideas about game theory optimal play do not take away from that. It's actually that a game theory optimal approach to poker, thinking in ranges, it's more practical, but it is, when you boil it right down, it really breaks down to what kind of mistakes you avoid and induce in accordance with the fundamental theorem of poker and in regards to EV. So just remember that EV is prior to. It's the thing that causes the GTO strategy to be the way that it is, in a sense. So let's talk about preflop equity. So there's this idea, right, that the amount of equity that your hand has is what should guide your decision-making process before the flop in No Limit Hold'em. I think it's wrong. You know, our hand's equity is only one of a handful of characteristics, but even just using it as the primary guide to determine whether you should take a flop or not, it really just doesn't make sense. You know, our hand's equity is one of the defining characteristics. It's not the only defining characteristic. And to think that it's a primary motivator for whether you should play or not play, I think is just leaving out too much. It's like, you have to think about how much equity does my opponent's range have against my hand, and how well does my hand realize its equity? That's true. That's fair enough. But it's not enough. It's not the end all be all. And when you start thinking about just equity pre-flop, then you're going to start making mistakes or spending time thinking about things that simply are not relevant, that just don't matter, and thinking in just kind of clunky, inefficient ways, going down tracks of thought that don't really make sense. And you know, ideas of protection just about invariably get smuggled in once we start talking about equity preflop. You know, like I three bet my pocket threes for protection. That's not a good way to think about it. The bottom line is if you three bet any hand, your opponent is either going to fold, and in what sense is that protecting anything? You know, if you three bet 7-2 offsuit and your opponent folds, did you protect your 7-2 offsuit? You're like, well, no, but if I have the best hand, I want to three bet and get my opponent to fold so he doesn't outflop me. Well, if your opponent folds, you don't win extra money for having the best hand or having had the best hand. The only things there really are to consider is your fold equity and then the situation you create when you get called. And I'm guilty of saying fold equity and equity when called as sort of a shortcut. But when you think about it a little deeper, it's not really just the equity when called. It's actually the spot, the situation that's going to arise, the post-flop scenario that you are likely to set up by playing this hand in a given way. So like I three bet my pocket threes from the big blind so that my opponent surrenders a lot of equity. It's just, it's clunky. I mean, it's a thing you can get into more trouble. It's dead weight. It's more harmful than it is good. I mean, it just, so I guess this is the question. How relevant is your preflop equity or a preflop equity model for guiding your decisions? That's the question. How much does it actually matter that your pocket fours have 52% equity against your opponent's ace king? I mean, what does that translate into? In what sense, if you take a flop with pocket fours against ace king offsuit, in what sense do you have 52% of anything? I mean, it's not viable in any way. I mean, you're not actually gonna win 52% of the time. You're gonna make some amount of money based on stacked depth, but in a lot of situations when you have smaller stack depth, shorter stacks, a hand like pocket twos, pocket sixes, it's actually not going to perform very well. It's not going to be profitable very often. Because basically you're trying to take a set mine, you know, and there's just not a big correlation between how much equity a hand has against a given range and how profitable or unprofitable that hand is likely to be in the actuality of poker, in the actual playing of every street. Like, how does that 52% equity translate into anything? Now, if you go all in preflop or you're deciding whether to call a shove preflop, or I guess even the closer you get to all in preflop, the more this idea of equity actually starts to matter. I mean, it's the only thing that matters if you get all the money in preflop. But to say that that equity model is tempered by post-flop considerations is, it's not enough. It's not just tempered, it's rendered all but useless. I mean, what does it matter that your Jack 2 offsuit has 32% equity? Is this relevant? That you have 32% equity against ace king, does that mean that you, as long as you're getting a bit more than 2-1 on a call, that you should take the call with Jack 2 offsuit? See, that's the kind of logic, or that's the kind of thinking or mistake that is brought about by this, I think, misguided view that somehow the equity that you have, if you are allowed to get to showdown, is actually relevant. I mean, it's just, as long as there's any money to bet post-flop, the relevance of your equity just, it all but goes out the window. Or we could say at best, it's one of a handful of things that needs to be considered. It's just one thing that you might, in certain situations, weigh in or take into account. But you can't really look at your hand's equity versus a range and try to translate that into EV. There's no way to do that. There's no sense in which that works. I mean, it could be, and I didn't check this, but it could be that a hand like 7-6 suited has roughly the same equity as a hand like Jack 2 offsuit against a given range. And surely we could come up with a range where that was the case. I don't think it would be all that hard. I don't think they're going to be that far apart against a hand like Ace King. But obviously you can see that one is going to way overperform, one's going to way underperform. And then you could try to tie that in and say, well, yeah, but that's because suited connectors overrealize their equity. And first of all, I don't think it's fair to say that, because the most equity a hand could actually realize is all of its equity. And that's not nothing. That's something that does matter, but it's not everything. In fact, you could say a hand like a small pocket pair has good value in a lot of situations exactly because it doesn't realize all of its equity, or that it under-realizes, and it absolutely does under-realize. A hand like pocket fours against an open raising range, 100 big blinds deep, for instance, is going to get most of its value from set mining, and almost none of its value from the fact that it just happens to have 52% raw equity against two overcards. It just doesn't come up. It's just not, it's not something that's going to matter. It's not, there's no decisions that are going to, or trains of thought that are viable that are going to come off of an understanding of how much equity a hand has against a given range, a given hand against a given range. There just really is no correlation once you get to a certain stack depth between, or there's only a very loose correlation, or a correlation only in specific situations with specific hands against very specific ranges, where there's going to be much of a correlation between a hand's raw equity and how it's going to perform post-flop. Again, it's not nothing, but it's not everything. It's not even close to everything. It's not enough to look at your hand and say, I probably have this much equity against my opponent's open raising range, and I'm getting the right price, so I should call. I mean, that just, it neglects too much of the game. I mean, it neglects almost all of the game. I mean, that's just a very small portion of what all is going on. It's like, I mean, this is said, I think, pretty well here. Hands do not play according to their equities. Equity models and thinking in terms of raw equity just don't account for, I mean, I jokingly said a couple minor little details about post-flop play, but really, I mean, these are huge things. One, you play one street at a time, and we could say, and there's multiple streets. Two, players are allowed to bet and they're allowed to raise. And three, sometimes hands get folded without a showdown. And again, I think this runs the risk of being not taken seriously enough. This might sound trite. It might sound like, yeah, I know, but, you know, still, it's like, be careful about the still part, because it just doesn't leave that much behind once you account for implied odds. There's a lot of things that matter in poker and poker strategy, and a lot of post-flop factors that are going to, or should help you to figure out what you should do with a given hand. And the raw equity really is not a big part of it. It's not nothing. And in some situations, it becomes more important. And I'm thinking about the four fundamental hand factors that the way that I try to think about post-flop play when I'm thinking about pre-flop hand selection is I think in terms of the four fundamental hand factors of the raw equity or built-in intrinsic showdown value. That's one, but it's just one. Domination, synergy, and nut potential. And I think that the raw equity is a pretty small part. It depends on the stack depth, but and it depends on the exact situation. Well, basically, smaller stack to pot ratios favor or put more emphasis or give more weight to domination and raw equity, and then deeper stacks give more weight or make more valuable nut potential and synergy. So basically, instead of looking at our hand's equity preflop, we should look at its EV or if its profitability or of the spot. We don't want to play hands, we play spots. You don't play hands, you play spots. So what kind of spots are you going to have post-flop if you play this hand in this way? That's what you need to think about. And the actual raw equity is not going to be a big part of that very often. It's not that big of a deal. It's certainly not something you should look at primarily. It shouldn't be your primary concern. And if you start modeling it that way, it's going to lead you to down trains of thought that are at best dead weight. you know, at best, inefficient. There's a lot of variables to consider when you're thinking about how to play a hand pre-flop. Stack depth, position, equity versus a given range, sure, that is one of the things. Ability to realize that equity post-flop, implied odds modifiers, the ability to realize said equity, comma, or next, post-flop implied odds modifiers. So we're talking about, again, the fundamental hand factors, it's domination. This is the way I break it down. It's kind of arbitrary. I mean, you could think of it in a lot of different ways. You could really just say there's equity, fold equity, and implied odds. And it would be, I mean, you could think of it that way. There's no problem. That's not incorrect. I think it's a little clunky, and I think the closest thing to the most efficient way that I've come up with or thought of or figured out is to think of it in terms of fold equity, of course, is going to be part of the conversation. But then the hand factors of domination, showdown value, or raw equity. So raw equity, showdown value, I'm calling the same thing. So raw equity, domination, nut potential, like how often are you going to flop a hand that you're happy to get stacks in with. Say like pocket fives have good nut potential because when you flop a set, you're going to be able to profitably get stacks in even on the flop, you know. And then synergy, which synergy actually does tie into the equity in some way, because the hand, when I say synergy, I'm talking about how well the two cards play together. Basically, like, how often am I going to hit flops in a way that allow me to profitably continue in the hand? Because the more synergy I have, the more of whatever amount of equity I have, I'm actually going to be able to realize. I'm going to actually be able to see the turn sometimes. If I have a hand like 9-8 suited or Jack 10 suited, I'm more likely to be able to see the turn in a profitable or break even or better scenario than with a hand like, you know, King 2 offsuit. Even though in a lot of situations, or let's use a couple of different hands. Like if I have 9-8 suited, I'm a lot more likely to realize more of my equity than if I have a hand like Queen 2 offsuit, or even Ace 2 offsuit. But if you take the hand Ace 2 offsuit against the hand King Queen offsuit, well, Ace 2 offsuit is actually an equity favorite against King Queen. But is it going to actually be profitable against that hand? Is Ace 2 offsuit going to be profitable against King Queen? I would say most of the time it's not. Now, if it's a pre-flop like reshove, yeah, it can be, where equity is really the only thing that matters. Fold equity and raw equity are the only thing that really matter in pre-flop like shove, reshove kind of poker. But anyway, the synergy that a hand has allows it to actually realize more of its equity. I'm going to be able to profitably or at least break even see the turn card when I have a hand like 9-8 suited compared to a hand like, you know, King 2 offsuit. Even though against a lot of hands, King 2 offsuit is going to have more raw equity than 9-8 suited, it's not going to matter. You know, it isn't going to realize that equity. It's going to be dominated too often. It's not very often that it's going to flop a hand that you're happy to play for stacks with. It's not got all the raw equity. So basically, it comes back to these ideas. We've got fold equity. We've got your post-flop edges, like playing skill, position, maybe range advantage to some degree. Depth, like how deep are you playing? How deep is your stack? And the deeper your stack is, the less important your raw equity actually is. And then, of course, your equity versus the range, but your ability, the ability that a hand has to realize that equity also. And then whatever other post-flop implied odds situations, synergies and nut potential. I mean, basically what I'm driving at here is that when you think about all of the things there are to think about, a hand's raw equity, it's not that important. It's a thing. It's one thing. But it's not the thing. So we shouldn't be looking at our pre-flop spots and saying, well, you know, I'm getting 2-to-1 here and I easily have 40% equity, so I have to make this call. That's just, it's not how poker works. It's at best dead weight. And I think at worst, it's going to have you going down the wrong trains of thought and kind of coming up with the wrong ideas. I just wanted to put this video out. Sorry it's been a little bit since I put my last video out. Hope you enjoyed it. Do all the YouTube stuff, like and subscribe, share it with friends, comment, tell me why I'm wrong. Tell me what you like, what you don't like. Comment on the new setup here. The audio quality should be better. And I think most people have said that this Prezi format seems a little bit better. That's what I think about that, boys and girls. So until next time, good quote, L-U-C-K, end quote. Namaste, poker homies. Word to your mothers, east side until I die. Peace out.